pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Please note the council's in full attendance, and I want to welcome everyone to our December 1 meeting. Almost done with the year. One more council meeting, I think, after this. So we'll move in our items from council. We do have A and B, those two items. I had talked to the city manager about maybe we could just go ahead and stay in order. We had anticipated maybe switching those, but we'll go ahead. The first item is we have a Muscular Dystrophy Association proclamation. I thought we'd go ahead and take care of that first before the next item.
This is a proclamation signed by the mayor on this date, and it reads in part, whereas the Victoria Professional Firefighters Local Number 3679 members selflessly donate their time and energy to supporting the battle against muscular dystrophy by filling the boot each year for the Muscular Dystrophy Association. And whereas in the past 3 years, the Victoria Professional Firefighters Local Number 3679 has raised more than $40,000 for MDA through the annual Fill the Boot campaign. And whereas the Professional Firefighters Local Number 3679's endless service to the MDA has given so much hope for families fighting neuromuscular diseases, therefore I, Paul Palasik, Mayor of the City of Victoria, Texas, do hereby proclaim December 5th, 12th, and 19th, 2015, as Victoria Professional Firefighters Local Number 3679 Fill the Boot Days in Victoria, and urge citizens to support the Muscular Dystrophy Association to fight the battle against muscular dystrophy.
Thank you. Does someone want to come forward for this? Okay.
It sounds like it's part of his regular countdown.
Thank you very much for having me this evening, Mayor and City Council members. Just wanted to thank you for the opportunity to thank the citizens of Victoria for all of their support over the past few years in the fight against muscular dystrophy. For the past over 60 years, firefighters have helped the Muscular Dystrophy Association by filling their boots with donations from citizens. And they have, in Victoria, raised over, as you said, $39,000, just $19,000 just in the last year, which is absolutely amazing. So I want to thank you on behalf of the families that the Muscular Dystrophy Association serves. And with your support, I know that we can grow these numbers and continue to provide hope for the families with fighting muscular dystrophy. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And I hope we have a successful, profitable fundraising effort. So thank you. We can. Our next item is the Ben Wilson Street Corridor Study Update. And Mr. Halapaska put that on the agenda.
Well,
and
I'll let the pros do it.
I do want to, before we get started, I know Dr. Morgan is here from University of Eastern Victoria. He has another event that started also at 5. And did you want to make remarks now so you could go, or is there, continue?
In order of what you're doing.
Okay, very good. Thank you. All right, then.
Good evening. So the MPO provided funding to complete the Ben Wilson Corridor study, and Friesen Nichols was hired to complete the study. So they did their analysis and prepared several alternatives and put that together in the draft report that you all had received a few weeks ago. They also did a presentation at the November MPO meeting, and tonight they will also be presenting to you on these alternatives. So tonight really marks the end of what we're calling phase one, which is is them preparing these alternatives and presenting. Provided there's consensus behind a alternative, we would then move into phase two, which would be further defining that preferred alternative. So with that, I'm just going to turn it over to Nick Sakavo with Friess & Nichols and let them present on the alternative. Thank you.
Thank you, Mary. Mayor, members of council, my name is Nick Sakavo, and I'm the project manager for Friess & Nichols. I office out of our Corpus Christi office. First of all, I'd like to take the opportunity to say thank you to the city for giving us the opportunity to provide a study and recommendations on this important project for not only the city, but for other stakeholders in the community. So this presentation is going to be an abbreviated presentation. We gave a much more detailed presentation to the MPO Policy Advisory Committee back on November 10th. But briefly, just wanted to define the study limits. We looked at Ben Wilson Street from the Houston Highway Business 59 to Sam Houston Drive. So those were the limits that we looked at as part of this study. The primary purpose of the study was to really twofold. One was to address the growing needs of University of Houston Victoria and to look for safer alternatives for pedestrians and other modes of transportation. The second item was to really look at the flow of traffic and make sure that we proposed a solution that addressed the flow of traffic on that corridor as well. We started this project back in August, and one of the first things that we did was, once school was back in session, we developed and counted the traffic out on Ben Wilson Street. After we counted the traffic, we developed a series of stakeholder meetings to really understand the needs of the stakeholders of this project. And so on this slide, I'm showing the primary stakeholders that we met with. Obviously, University of Houston Victoria, Victoria College, Citizens Medical Center, some of the residential neighborhoods such as Bronson Terrace we met with as well, and some of the other minor stakeholders along this corridor. And right now I'd like to turn it over to our traffic engineer, Kevin St. Jakes. And before I do that, I'd also like to mention that we also teamed with Civil Corps on this project, and Ben Galvan is here with us today as well, and Ben provided a lot of support and a lot of local knowledge for this project as well. So I'm going to turn it over to Kevin, let Kevin present the detailed traffic study.
Great. Thank you, Nick. All right, as we looked at the corridor, we had to make sure we understood its function within the network of streets that were operating parallel to the corridor. So we looked at the volumes that were along Laurent, and Ben Jordan and Ben Wilson as a collective of streets that are serving that north-south movement to understand really how Ben Jordan falls into that network of streets. So we saw that, you know, in the core it's a little busier. As it gets further out, it gets less and less traffic, but it's still part of a necessary linkage. So one of the early alternatives, hey, we just closed Ben Wilson, was kind of taken off the table and say, well, Ben Wilson's an important part of the network and to continue on. And then we looked at the host of historical traffic volumes on the streets to understand how its behavior and that it's a fairly consistent, consistently modestly growing corridors in those three corridors. Let me make sure I press the right button here. Then we looked at the future traffic. You know, what is the development of this university going to do? What is our 2040 forecast? The Metropolitan Transportation Plan say is going to happen on this corridor. The 2040 plan says we're going to have about 10, maybe 15% growth over the next 25 years up to 2040. But the UHV plan says that we're going to have about that 10 to 15 to 20% growth like in 10 years with the advancement of their university. So we used a 20% growth kind of as where we think this corridor is going, even though the 2040 plan considers some growth of the university. It didn't really anticipate that much growth. And so we're going up above the 10%, looking at a 20% growth in traffic for that corridor as our baseline of what this corridor needs to accommodate as we look at the alternatives that are under consideration. Traffic operations, what we did is we looked at how are things operating now with two lanes each direction, a center turn lane up and down this corridor, and then what could be a minimum amount of lanes that would still accommodate traffic. And so we analyzed two different scenarios from a real detailed traffic assessment. One is a 5-lane, the other basically is a 3-lane, one lane direction with a center turn lane, and we actually brought Red River down to a 3-lane operation and up an airline to the west of Ben Wilson as a 3-lane. Just really brought it down, bare bones, minimum number of lanes. And we're still finding that even with that level of lanes and that traffic, we're still at okay. So we knew that, okay, now we've got kind of a range of alternatives to consider as we look at analyzing back and forth between one and the other. We could consider Ben Wilson as a 3-lane roadway in a series of alternatives. And then we were to go then look at what are the other things we're trying to accomplish. And so in the development of the next set of alternatives, we first look at the goals that we're trying to do. And traffic operations, you know, this road, we had to make sure we had good traffic operations on this roadway in whatever alternative we consider. So in a scoring of out of 100 points, we value that at 30% of that total. The next was looking at the pedestrian and bicycle mobility and safety needs of this corridor with all the students coming in and the new residential halls for the university. We knew that bicycle pedestrian mobility would be a key, so we also assigned that an equal value of 30 points up and down this corridor. And then we looked at, okay, now we got to think about cost. We don't want to overspend money. We want to make sure we're prudent in our investments. And so we assigned the cost of these solutions 25 points out of the 100. And then finally, we have the opportunity to make this corridor kind of a statement about our city and enhance its attractiveness. And so we assigned corridor aesthetics and what you could do with this corridor, with the whatever else you were trying to do with it from roadways, et cetera. If you could have room and ability to enhance the aesthetics, we assigned that the remaining 15 points out of the 100. So that became our goals for the alternative and also our scoring criteria as we moved forward with the alternatives. Now, in the corridor, we had a host of things that could be done, and so we went through, and most of these alternatives have this host of enhancements to one degree or another. We've got HOC pedestrian signals, which is a pedestrian-activated crossing that stops the traffic. Pedestrian signal heads at the other signalized intersections, raised medians to create pedestrian refuge areas for crossing the street one direction of traffic at a time, enhancing the sidewalks along the edges, enhancing the landscape, creating some, one of the alternatives actually adds a great separated pedestrian area. So we've got a lot of things that are going into the mix of the alternatives that we're taking a look at. One that you may not be familiar with, and we can go further detail of this, is the HOC pedestrian signal. That basically is it's a signal that hangs out over the road like a regular traffic signal, except it's dark, all the indications are off. Until a pedestrian comes up and pushes the button, at which point the flashing yellow comes on, and then the signal goes to solid yellow and solid red. So the cars come to a stop, and the pedestrians are safe to cross the street. And they get pedestrians see a walk, don't walk, like at a regular crossing. And then for a certain time that we designate, the signal goes back to a flashing red and then goes off. And it stays off until a pedestrian feels that he needs that safe crossing. Doesn't always have to press that crossing to cross the road, but that's there for them if they feel they need to stop the cars to get across. All right, then we put together a set of alternatives that would kind of compare well against each other in meeting these criteria and the goals established. We have three primary alternatives and kind of an A and a B off each of those. And I'll briefly walk through each of these. But basically, the number one leaves our five-lane condition and enhances it in a nice way. The alternative number two actually creates a pedestrian crossing underneath Ben Wilson. And enhancement number three brings everything down to that three-lane configuration to really make it easier to cross the street and negotiate the corridor. Alternative 1A, and I won't go in depth in these because you've got it in your report, but basically 1A is basically the minimal treatments we can do to enhance this corridor. So five lanes stays as it is, the curb lines are right where they are. We kind of mill and overlay the surface of the roadway to kind of give it a nice finish, restripe it fresh, but it basically is a five-lane roadway. And this cost is about $2.7 million. It's significantly lower than the rest of the alternatives that you'll see because it is just a mill and overlay, and it will not have the length of duration, the life of the pavement in the other alternatives that you'll see, which are basically a total reconstruction of the pavement. So that's kind of the one difference in this. But we felt it was a good baseline alternative to compare all of the rest of them to, is that it's just enhances existing. What it does, it adds the Hawk crossing, that pedestrian crossing at the locations, the two locations along the corridor, right at the main drive and then at the new residential dorms area where there'd be another crossing. So it adds those pedestrian crossings. It adds a bit of enhanced landscape along the edges. It raises some of the median areas at certain places, so you got some planter areas. So it begins to create the essence of the enhanced corridor, the attractiveness. But it can only go so far because we've still got, you know, a five-lane street, essentially. Alternative 1B starts to get at bringing some of the pavement down. It basically takes the area that's north of the university up to Airline and Sam Houston and brings it down to a four-lane condition. And we started to introduce this thing that's called a road diet, you know, bringing the width of the roadway down and providing just the amount of lanes that would be needed for moving everything. In that section, we basically have only one little side street and a couple of small businesses, and there's not a lot of turning movement, so the 12 or 16-foot wide center turn lane is kind of rarely used. So if you take that and reallocate that space out to the edges, you could add landscaping. On the one side, you got sidewalk right against the back of the curb, not a very attractive place to be walking, so you could add some green space between it, buffer area, and the moving traffic. And so it starts to enhance that part of the corridor where it's needed. The rest of the south, we've got some areas that can be enhanced readily. So we start to move that landscaped edge further north, all the way up to Sam Houston. Then we looked at a different way of looking at this corridor and brought in a grade-separated crossing, and it was kind of prompted by something that somebody mentioned after one of our other meetings that we were meeting. So why don't you just have the pedestrians cross over? And so we looked at different ways of doing it, and then crossing over, you know, pedestrians aren't going to use it. If we did a tunnel under, there's too many things underneath the road. So what we did is we looked at an alternative to actually lift Sam Houston, Ben Wilson up about 15 feet and get a 10-foot tall tunnel passageway underneath Ben Wilson. And it wouldn't be as much of a tunnel because we're going to separate the roads. There'll be the median area, so it'll be light under there pretty much. But it would create a much safer pedestrian crossing under there. Be very expensive because you got bridge work, you got a lot of maintenance with the bridges and things like that, but it would create that high intensity pedestrian crossing area for the two sides of the university now as it grows. Pedestrians would still tend to cross at some of the other locations, so we'd have another Hawk signal down at the future garage that's going to be down there. So there's other things that would also go along with this alternative. We thought it was significant enough an alternative to be interesting to take a look at and weigh against all the other alternatives that we're thinking at. Again, the big deal is the you know, unencumbered pedestrian crossing from the two sides of Ben Wilson. And that one, we had an alternative 2A, which was the 5 with the 4 to the north. And we introduced a 2B, which started to get at bringing that northern end a little bit narrower even by just going to one lane each direction with a center turn lane to really bring up the pedestrian nature of that northern end and make it easier to cross there. It also addresses some of the tightness of a corner that's over at Airline on that southwest corner. There's a very, very tight little corner where there's a power pole right in this, and it's really not ADA accessible, and there's some things that need to be done about that corner. So this would begin to give the room to be able to do that at that corner. And then the third set of alternatives, and if I could back up just by comparison, the price tag on putting the bridge and everything in there on that alternative is like $9.5 million, so it's quite significant. Alternative 3A, we go down to just a three-lane alternative, one lane each direction with a center area that can be used for raised medians, continuous turn lanes as we need them. 3A keeps the 5-lane that's south of Red River down to 59 Business, and 3B basically brings the 3-lane all the way down through the entire corridor. We have, again, acceptable traffic operations even with the growth up to 20% more than, in effect, we modeled it all the way up to 40% more traffic and it still worked acceptably. So we've got actually more traffic buffer than what we plan to have to accommodate for the future in this 3-lane alternative. So getting down kind of to the summarize, the alternatives for you. Looking at our scoring, we scored the traffic operations goal, the pedestrian mobility safeties goal, the cost-effective solution goal, the corridor aesthetics goal. For each of those six combinations of alternatives, the higher ranking, as we looked at the goal achievements, were the 2 3-lane options, the 3A and 3B, with the highest technically being the 3-lane that leaves the 5-lane south of Red River down to Business 59, but very, very close in score overall was bringing the 3-lane all the way down to the edge. Price tag is about $7.8 million for the 5-lane, or 3-lane leaving the 5-lane, and 7.3 or so for the other 3-lane alternatives. So both of them very close in score, both of them very close in price tag. So we thought we would leave it at that point and leave it open for any questions that you might have.
Council, you have questions at this point?
Was drainage considered in any of these?
Yes. The big picture drainage issue, and Ben Galvan can speak to that further, the big picture is kind of outside the range of this that's kind of constrained the drainage overall. But what we did in the corridor, for all except that 1A alter, 1A is just kind of service streets and doesn't do anything. 1B and beyond actually replaces all the pavement. So when we got the pavement up, the cost that's included in this adds another parallel storm drain pipe, basically just to store more drainage underneath the pavement so it doesn't erupt up into the roadway when we get the overflow. And so that would help to resolve some of that pavement issue. And that's a good portion of that $7.5 million price tag is all the underground things that we're going to do in addition to repaving the streets.
Thank you.
I've got some questions, comments myself, but I'm just waiting to see if anybody else, and also kind of wanted to hear from Dr. Morgan too. And anybody? Nothing. Okay, seeing none. This concludes your part, your discussion.
Yes, it does.
Okay. Is anyone else going to go further?
Kevin? No, no.
Okay. And if it's appropriate, do you know of anybody else? No, we didn't.
Dr. Morgan,
if you would share your thoughts and comments. I know Dr. Hines is here too. And I don't think he has any comments, but you're welcome. If you change your mind, come on up. So, okay.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, council members. We've obviously seen these proposals and looked at them. And as far as UHV's ideal choice here, it would be that 3B, which changed everything to three lanes from 59 down to Airline, or maybe it was Sam Houston that they went to. That seems to handle the traffic flow. That lets that corridor look more like a college campus than it does just a street. Obviously, the speed limits would need to be lowered on a two-lane road. The turning lanes and the pull-out lanes would allow plenty of access, I think, if there were emergency vehicles that were needing to flow up and down that. There would be ways for the cars to get out of the way. It provides a safe and secure environment for students crossing. Our ultimate goal is about 1,200 beds on the other side of Ben Wilson, with the academic buildings and the campus on the current side of Ben Wilson. So you're looking at a lot of students crossing the street, and those students likely would not go to the crosswalks if there were just two of them. Students are notorious for dashing across the street. And if it was a tunnel that they had to go under, they'd have to go to it. But students tend to just cross where they can and near where they are, as opposed to walking up and down the street to cross. So we believe that that 3B would be the ideal alternative. Also, as you come off of 59, if you leave that a five-lane road until you get to Red River, cars simply build up speed. And if they hit that green light going into a three-lane road, they may already be running 40 miles an hour before they come in there, where the speed limit would drop to, say, 30 or 25 or whatever the magic number is. So we believe that the three-lane road would give us more of a college atmosphere, would let us go ahead and deal with the medians and the greenery in the medians and the sides, and make it look like a college street as you turn off of 59. I think that would also lend itself to getting to Red River, and Red River ultimately looking like a college street for Victoria College. Some signage at the corner there that would indicate UHV and Victoria College, and I think we could make that whole section look like a campus setting pretty easily there.
What timeline, I know this is very preliminary, when would you expect to have this road changed?
Yesterday it'd probably be okay. No, I know what construction takes and how much time it takes. We're looking at building that first residence hall, 380 beds, and having that complete in time for a move-in for August of 2017. The closer to that date we are with the road issues, then the more likely we are to have the safe environment as we move students into that residence hall. We're also, at our last Regents meeting, we got permission to begin to plan and construct the student center and the learning commons, which in the pictures that you have come right out of that U. It comes from the campus now, those two square buildings that are right in the middle. Those two buildings would probably open either in the fall of 17 or early spring 18. So we're looking at the student center and the library learning commons in late 17, early 18, the residence hall in August of 17. So we'd like to see that move forward on those timelines.
Okay. And it's too early to talk about financing, I suppose. Y'all have some thoughts. I know this obviously will be a partnership.
It will be, and we have some resources at this point that we can put into this project in terms of what portion and what ratio. We'll have to look at the cost and look at what we can do. We obviously, just to be blunt, we can only spend money on land we own. So if we narrowed it to two lanes with a center turning lane, we'd need to work out some arrangement for those outside lanes so that we could actually spend resources on those lanes.
Okay. Yeah, we'd be changing the right-of-way.
Right.
Yeah, okay.
Right. That's state law, I think, I believe.
Wayne. I think I've heard that.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. So we're very preliminary in all of this.
Very, very much so. And I know that it doesn't happen yesterday.
Right. Right.
So it's the whole process. We'll also be looking at another academic building, which we think will open in probably 18, or late spring 18 or fall 18.
Okay. Well, I know that I'm going to hear from constituents about it, and I think tonight, in my mind, Council, you know, it's just about let's get this out and say this is what we're looking at, and I'm going to try to keep an open mind. I have one of these that I prefer right now, but I'm not even going to mention what it is at this point. I want to listen and get more feedback. This study is available. Is this available online anywhere, Kevin?
Yeah,
okay.
It's on the MPO website.
Okay.
And also, there's the more detailed presentation that was done at the MPO meeting is also on the MPO website.
Okay. Do you have any additional hard copies of this evening? Do y'all have any? Okay, that's fine. Okay. Mr. Halpaska.
Dr. Morgan, at the MPO, when this presentation was made, y'all indicated that you would like to have either 3A or 3B. I see that seemed to have shifted slightly towards 3B.
3B, just for the reasons that I mentioned.
Okay.
I think it allows the turnoff of 59 to look like you're coming into a college campus. And ultimately, I anticipate that UHV will expand some that direction. That is, you'll be close to on the campus once you make that turn. We anticipate a parking garage there at the corner of Red River and Ben Wilson on the, I guess that would be the northeast corner. Is that right?
It would be the southeast corner.
Southeast corner.
Yes, sir.
Of Ben Wilson. And we believe that the traffic patterns would accommodate that at the three-lane turn-in. So our preference would be the 3B as the first choice, with the three lanes all the way to 59. Obviously, we'd rather have 3A than 1A, 1B, 2A, or 2B. But in terms of our prioritization, 3B would be number one, 3A would be number two.
Thank you so much.
I think part of what Council, you know, whether we need to put this back on the next agenda is eventually we need a recommendation out of you on what plan so that Friesen Nichols can go to phase two on developing that plan further. Like you said, this was kind of phase one of the alternative, so eventually we'll need that decision point.
To narrow it down.
To narrow it down, yes, sir.
Charmel, at this point, do we know, or I know we don't have any costs associated or, you know, other than this, but what percentage would we be having to match?
I think that's a discussion that we need to have after we decide what plan, and then representatives, Dr. Morgan and Mr. Barron and my staff sit down and let's talk through that, you know, what's appropriate, what can the university pay for, and then what could the city pay for. So.
Would there be other proponents to this pie, or that would just be just us and them?
Well, on Ben Wilson, it would be us and the University of Houston, Victoria. And then eventually, if we want to look down Red River and do some, updates on Red River along these same lines, a Hawk signal, if we choose to do that for pedestrian crossing, at Victoria College to Citizens Hospital, they have a crossing there for students back and forth, then we'd need to sit down and visit with VC on available help with that funding too. So, but the sooner we can move into phase two, it helps us plan from a financial standpoint on, springtime when we start looking at, get into the spring on when we do CIP conversations and where our funding's gonna be and trying to accommodate 2017.
I did have a further question, perhaps an engineering question. As I noticed that the work on 3B is much more extensive, yet it is a lower number on the cost, and that seems counterintuitive. Would the engineering firm or engineer people have an answer on that?
A lot of money.
I think on 3B, the difference in the lower cost is because we're actually constructing less pavement, and there's where the cost lies. There'll be more green space and less pavement. So we're between Red River and Business 59 would be a three-lane section, so we'd be constructing less square yardage of pavement, which would be the difference in the cost. Yep.
Grass is cheaper than asphalt.
That's correct. The utilities and the other items are the same.
Thank you, sir.
So since it's clear the university cannot spend money on property they don't own, and they do not own the street, it's the city street, and it's our decision, but maintenance, that green area, and that, can the university do any maintenance? Y'all can keep that mowed and cleaned up?
I believe we can. Mr. Barron says we can. Mr. Barron says we can.
Thank you. And I know that's subject to further discussion. I'm just,
sure.
It's a possibility that could be worked out.
Sure.
Okay.
Absolutely.
Y'all do quite a bit of maintenance on your existing properties already, and you do
right.
An excellent job. And okay. Okay. Something to consider. Well, my thoughts, I'm trying to envision this 20 to 30 years from now. Because it's going to be so different. That many students, that's new. It's new to us. It really is. And I would encourage really the public to look far down the road as what we expect that area to look like. I think it's going to grow, and I know it's exciting, and we have to think of it. I have to think of it differently. So, and I'm trying to do that, all balancing the concerns of traffic flow and safety. I think if we start out on the right foot, we can train those students. They can cross the street. I know they can. We just have to put in some rules and get them started off on the right foot, literally and figuratively. So, Council, did y'all have any?
Can I ask an engineering question?
Yes, ma'am.
Please do.
I know that we talked once about the sewer lines being not under the street, so that way you don't have to break up the street. Would that be considered at this for this street or not?
Not sewer, storm drains, yes.
Okay.
But I don't think we have any plan. Lynn's shaking his head, no. I don't think we have any plans to do anything with the sewer. It's storm drains.
Well, the storm, I meant the
But then storm. Ben and Freeze and Nichols, they're the ones that did the design. Ben, is it sewer or just storm drain?
What's in the street,
yeah.
I guess.
What's underneath the street?
Just the storm drain. My understanding is that the sanitary sewer has been rehabilitated, but there is some work to do on the existing manholes, but it would just be the storm drainage.
Okay.
Just to take care of the drainage problem there, you know, so that's all.
The problem on the storm drain, I believe, lies farther down near the intersection of Ben Jordan and
Airline?
59, is it? Or where is it? Can you tell me, Lynn?
Well, we have to do a lot of work towards Sam Houston and then coming down.
There's major master drainage plan renovations that would need to occur ultimately for down Red River all the way to Lone Tree Creek. And I know that is not included in this proposal. I've looked at the proposal and what they're proposing here is an additional interceptor up Ben Wilson to provide some more storage there for that. And, you know, and hopefully with detention and that sort of thing.
I was gonna say, with any development, the developer is gonna have to detain any runoff. So as University of Houston Victoria builds, they're going to have to build the detention in, or you know, into their plans. So,
okay. The retention can be underground by oversized lines.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah.
They do have to abide by the drainage. I know in the building codes they do not, but well, the spirit of them.
They will want to abide. They don't want to build a building that's going to have water in it. So,
yeah.
So would you like for me to put this back on for further discussion on the 15th and then the next meeting in 2 weeks to try to give some direction? I don't get a sense that y'all are ready to give me direction tonight.
I actually think that's a little early.
Okay, so the first meeting in January?
January, perhaps.
Yeah.
In a second.
I would like you to already have had the discussion with them about.
Well, they have to know which plan. So, I mean, it's because what they're able to come to the table with is going to depend on the plan for our cost and their cost. So, but I mean, I can sit down and have a preliminary discussion on what ifs, but
Yeah, because if it came back and said 100%, I might change my decision on which plan.
They're not going to do 100% just because of the fact that they... Oh, us? Oh, no. I think there's a partnership here to be had. What I encourage you to do is think long-term. You know, I realize that we're planning today, but we need to be thinking long-term on what that area is going to look like as this university grows. Because it's, you know, we have an opportunity right now to kind of do it right for the future. And, you know, so I would, you know, think along those lines. And I know it's difficult at times because we want to solve what's there today, but it was the projected growth of 6,000 students. That area is just going to look so different, as will this community with those students and building the dorms there. You know, just I ask you to think broadly. So
change is hard.
Well, and that was the whole idea. The MPO even looked at this. Mm-hmm. We see a future problem looming. Mm-hmm. Can we address it now, or at least partially address it now, or rather than wait for it to fall down on our head? And so many of these projects seem to happen that way.
And the MPO did vote unanimously to support the 3A and B concept.
Oh, thank you for reminding me of that. So the MPO,
we went through this very extensively on the MPO and did vote unanimously that 3A and 3B were our choices. And they have indicated that they prefer 3B, which is a longer extension. But they're both almost identical other than that.
Well, let's do the first meeting in January.
The 5th? Okay.
Can I ask another question? I'm sorry, but I'm thinking. You mentioned the CIP list. How is that going to affect the current CIP list that we have for next year and the following year? Are we going to have to adjust that CIP list?
Very well, might have to. We need to get into those financials of our projects and stuff. Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Once we know a cost.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah.
Very good.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Morgan and Friesen Nichols, and appreciate your work.
Listen, thank you. We appreciate it. I think you're going to see some exciting things happening at UHB over the next 2 to 4 years, and I think it's going to be a wonderful time for the university. I think it's going to be a great time for Victoria College. I think it's going to be a great time for the city of Victoria, and I think it's just going to be a positive, upbeat experience as we bring these students and these opportunities for the students to the campus. I can't imagine that you're not going to see a lot of additional commercial development in the area up and down 59 and around where the campus is going to be, out that direction as well. So thank you for your consideration, and we'll look forward to visiting with you again on the first meeting in January, I guess.
Yes, sir.
Thank you,
Dr. Morgan. Okay, we're still under items from council. Is there anything in particular that is not on the agenda you want to bring up?
Can I pull D6?
You want to pull D6?
Yes, please.
Absolutely. And I failed to at the beginning of the meeting. We do have a scout here. I want to recognize him. I know the Boy Scouts often attend they're working on citizenship in the community, probably. Okay, very good. So hopefully you find the meeting interesting, so welcome. Okay, nothing else under items from council? Mr. Alvarez?
Do we have an update for the Christmas events coming up?
I can do a reminder. This Friday night, at 6 o'clock, we have Christmas in the square at De Leon Plaza. That's a children's event with lots of children's activities. And then they're showing Jack Frost. I'm looking for somebody from Park. Jack Frost, that starts at 7 o'clock. Right? 7 o'clock for the Jack Frost? Okay, good.
And then the Christmas parade.
And the Christmas parade is Saturday at 6 p.m. So, right. And the weather forecast is beautiful, so hope it holds.
Excellent. Excellent.
Okay. Good. Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Alvarez, you're playing Santa Friday, aren't you? That's what I heard.
I'm in training.
Okay. But I'm not going to sit on your lap. All right. Yeah, I hope to see everybody there Friday night. That is a very enjoyable event. So. Okay, let's see, that concludes items from council. We'll move into citizens communication. So anyone here that would like to come up and speak on anything at all, including the Ben Wilson study, whatever, if you'd come forward and give us your name and address for the record, and then try to keep the comments to 5 minutes. So now's the time. Anyone would like to come forward? Okay, seeing no one, oh, there's somebody. Ms. De Leon.
This way I can go first and last. Mayor, council members, my name is Blanche De Leon. I live at 236 Adcock Road in Victoria, Victoria County. Tonight, I'd like to remind us of something that we walk by or drive by every day. Right in our midst in De Leon Plaza, also known as De Leon Park, is a monument, and it reads, "To the explorers and founders and the colonists of early Texas who had a love for freedom, a hunger for great things, and the courage to reach for them, these Texas stones are dedicated. To all who have an eagerness to make each day of their lives better and to make their country greater, to all known and unknown who believe that this is a good place to live and prosper and to worship their God as they see fit, this monument is dedicated. To all who gave to the goodness and progress of this area and to the greatness of this state and this nation, we, the living, who have received this rich heritage, dedicate our lives." This, ladies and gentlemen, is on the monument that is on the corner of Forest and Main Street in Victoria on our De Leon Plaza, also known as De Leon Park. Many of you know, some of you in the audience may not know, that I have proposed to request land to build a De Leon monument to the founders of Victoria right in front of this monument that would be matching granite, red granite, a red granite block that comes out of the little piece of landscape right in front to size of the founders, Martin De Leon and Patricia De La Garza. And as such, I have developed a De Leon Memorial, Inc., a nonprofit organization whose sole purpose is to fundraise, conceptualize, build, erect, dedicate, and celebrate that monument. Participating in such an endeavor allows the citizens of Victoria, who also have been left with this legacy as this memorial reads, an opportunity to honor Victoria's founders, celebrate the values of family, community, education, and God, the values on which this community was both founded, built, and continues to be built on today, advance the knowledge of migration into Texas, of which Victoria, Texas holds a unique place in Texas history, nurture historic preservation, and also foster tourism, support Victoria Main Street, and beautify De Leon Park. Tonight, you will be voting on a resolution E1 to grant De Leon Memorial, Inc., that little piece of property on which to accomplish this end. I would like to thank you for considering this project, and I hope that we will all vote positively for this project that can truly synergize our community, where we can all get together and work for a common good and common interest of our community. I'd also like to thank Emmett Alvarez for stepping out there, being one of the first donors to the success of this project. Thank you very much for your time. I hope that you are also going to put a positive vote in for me, Emmett, for this project. Thank you again, Mayor and Councilman. I really think this is a project that is worthy of my time, my effort, and also would advance Victoria as a community and beautify our downtown area, which we love so much. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Okay. Citizens communication still open. Oh. Please come forward and give us your name and address for the record. Mr. Conway.
Mayor, Councilman, I'm Wayne Conway, 2002 College Drive in Victoria. We have not seen, well, there's two things on Ben Wilson, the Knights of Columbus Hall, and the church. We're worried about, because we have not seen anything on this proposal, of us coming out of our driveways and being able to turn to the left. Do we have an opening there, or do we have a proposal there? We have not seen, you know, the picture in the paper doesn't show anything that much. And we're curious about it.
It depends on which option, and I want to make sure you guys get a copy of that. That's why I'd ask earlier if there was any additional ones. Matter of fact, I could give you this one later, Mr. Conway.
All right, appreciate it.
And it's got each of the six alternatives. Of course, they're online as well. I believe Mary said that they can be printed there.
You got an old computer like I got, you don't get much online.
I kind of suspected you would say that. So, absolutely. And then, you know, before our meeting in January, if you guys, hopefully anyone concerned wants to come that night, also share their thoughts.
That is our main concern.
We don't,
the proposal is good, but our concern is getting out of the driveway. Thank you.
Well, and that will definitely be taken into consideration when they design that. So,
yes, sir.
Thank you.
Mr. Conway? If I may, there's a very large picture here. Perhaps one of these could be provided to y'all. It's a lot clearer when you see a big picture.
Anything that helps us out, that's all. So we should see it. Thank you.
Okay. You bet. We'll be in touch. Thank you. Okay. Citizens communication still open. Is there anyone else at this point that would like to come forward? Okay, I see no one jumping up, so we'll go ahead and close citizen communications and move into the rest of our agenda. We do have two ordinances without public hearings first.
Yes, sir. Item C1 is an ordinance amending Chapter 24 of the Victoria City Code to address special events and athletic field fees, repealing conflicting parts of existing ordinances, providing for codification and savings, and declaring an effective date.
Council?
So moved.
Second.
Motion and second. Any discussion? This is the second, third reading on this. Okay. Very good. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? Thank you. C2.
Item C2 is an ordinance amending Chapter 24 of the Victoria City Code to add a credit card surcharge and address convenience fees, repealing conflicting parts of existing ordinances, providing for codification and savings, and declaring an effective date.
Make a motion to approve C2.
Second.
A motion and a second. Is there any questions or discussion?
Absolutely, Ms. I know that you said the $3 charge is going to be on credit card charges, but even the ones you go to make at the office, it's just the convenience fee that's not going to be charged if you go pay at the office, right?
Okay. That's correct.
And you can actually do bank draft and not have, that's just credit card, right?
Yeah, the ACH is not going to charge
you anything. The ACH does not have a charge at this time.
That's right, you missed that meeting.
We
talked about it considerably. I just want to stress, and correct me if I'm wrong, this is just a cost recovery. It's what they're charging us.
That's true.
We're trying to recover the cost. It's not, we don't make any money here or anything. That's not our intention.
Could you repeat your questions and make sure I understood that correctly?
That the credit card charge is going to be done for the, what is it, online, but not the face, even the face-to-face, you're charging them $3?
At the billing office.
At the billing office, if you're paying with a credit card, you're going to charge them $3.
Yes, ma'am. Cross the board at the billing for any billing office charges.
Okay, and the convenience fee is not going to be charged if you pay in person. That's what I understood.
With a credit card, you'll be charged. If you use a credit card in person at the office, at the utility billing office, you will be charged a $3 surcharge for the use of the credit card.
Maybe I
they
can
said
help
this
clarify.
Convenience fee will not be added to persons making
the
a payment.
The convenience
cash.
Yes. Yes, Ms. Solis, I can clarify that a little bit by saying this is an either or. The surcharge is applying only at UBO, the utility billing office. The convenience fee is for other departments within the city.
Okay. It seemed like it was for both the same. Okay. I understand now.
Thank you.
Of course, I mean, it's itemized here for us because I guess we have to, and I'm trying to remember some of that discussion. You know, a large retailer, it's just in the cost of goods. You don't see it itemized, but there are all kind of fees attached to using credit cards. So that's a true statement, I suppose. I think that's how we said it 2 weeks ago. So Okay. Any further discussion on C2? If not, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? Okay, C2 passes. C3 does have a public hearing. We'll go ahead and read the ordinance first.
C3 is an ordinance amending Chapters 5 and 9 of the Victoria City Code by adopting the 2015 International Building Code Series and the 2014 National Electric Code as amended and modified herein, repealing all conflicting ordinances, providing for enforcement and a penalty upon conviction not to exceed $2,000, respectively, providing for publication, codification, and savings, and declaring an effective date.
So let's go ahead and open the public hearing and see who wants to speak to this. I know the Development Services Department, the Board of Adjustment Appeals, they did look at all this quite extensively. I think some of them are here. Thank you for your time and thank you for looking at it. But if anyone wants to come forward and speak on C3, now would be the time. Okay, seeing no one, we'll close that public hearing. I'll entertain a motion.
Move we adopt.
Second.
A motion and a second. Is there questions? Staff, did you want to make any comments at this time or?
I can. I just wanted to make sure y'all are aware of kind of why we were doing it. It is in our CM1. The last 2009 building codes were adopted in 2011. So it's been a little while since we've updated, and we skipped a 2012 generation of codes in there to get to where we are today. As you already stated, there were numerous workshops that were held by our department. Rick and his folks reached out to the building and development community and worked with the Board of Adjustments and Appeals. Actually, there were 8 workshops, and they developed a series of amendments to the codes that are before you tonight, and they do unanimously recommend adoption of those. We will be back sometime later this summer to deal with the energy code so that we are in compliance with state law that takes effect September 1, 2016. So you're doing some amendments to the energy code tonight, but it doesn't get us in full compliance. It takes us partway there, but it doesn't get us in full compliance with that state law. So we'll have to come back and try to address those at a later date.
Okay. Council, any questions? Let me see if Ms. Elise will come back in. I'll give her a minute. I know that I have to say this. I know y'all heard me say it before, but I've always frustrated, and I know Jared's heard me say this about some of these building codes, and I feel like we have to adopt them. And I'm glad that the Board of Appeals and others with a lot of expertise look at it, but every time there's a new set of codes out, it seems to further slightly restrict what a homeowner or builder can do, and it's always that part frustrates me a bit. And I realize it's tied to insurance companies wanting to make sure that houses don't burn and lives aren't lost. But every time, you know, we do that, I did read through there. And little things are in there. You know, you can no longer have a door from your garage to a sleeping area, I believe, a bedroom. I suppose that was a source of some fires at some point. So every time there's a new code, it restricts it down further. So anyway, but I am going to support it. I will say that. Any further questions, staff? Any comments? Okay, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? Thank you. Thank you, Jared. The consent agenda, you want to just do 1 through 8 minus 6 first?
Sure. Okay. There are 7 items remaining on the consent agenda. They are first the approval of minutes of the special joint meeting with Victoria Sales Tax Development Corporation on November 9th, 2015, and the regular meeting held on November 17th, 2015. Second, a resolution reappointing members to the Board of Directors of the Victoria Sales Tax Development Corporation and declaring an effective date. Third, a resolution reappointing board members to the Building and Standards Commission and declaring an effective date. Fourth, a resolution authorizing the city manager to execute a contract with Pictometry International Corporation to provide aerial imagery and planimetrics for the City of Victoria's geographic information system in the amount of $113,737 and declaring an effective date. Fifth, a resolution approving the purchase of 2 trailer-mounted air compressors from Victory Air Equipment Incorporated for a total of $33,700, authorizing the city manager to execute all documents necessary to complete the purchase and declaring an effective date. Item D7 is a resolution authorizing the city manager to execute a contract with Zambelli Fireworks to provide fireworks for the 2016 4th of July fireworks show in the amount of $30,000 and declaring an effective date. And item D8 is a resolution approving the purchase of speed detection devices for use by the police department from Custom Signals Incorporated in the amount of $31,346.92 authorizing the city manager to execute all documents necessary to finalize the purchase and declaring an effective date.
So moved.
Move to adopt.
We have a motion and a second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Mr. Halpaska, did you vote aye on that one?
Aye.
Okay. Just for the record. Thank you. Okay, D6.
Item D6 is a resolution approving payment of the annual maintenance cost to the Searcy Corporation to provide software support and maintenance for the Victoria Public Library's integrated library system in the amount of $36,768.90 and declaring an effective date.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Is there a discussion, Ms. Solis?
I noticed this is the third year for the contract. Are we going to go for bids in 2016-17, or are we renewing with them? Because it didn't state it on the...
I suspect we will renew with them because that software system is a very complex software system, so you don't just, unless it's not working for you, you don't just throw it out and start all over. But I'll let Dana speak too, so...
That's correct. We are we're preparing to contact Searcy Dynex and talk with them about what that type of contract would look like. Are we looking at a 3-year, a 5-year? I think they'll give us probably several options, and then we'll be looking at what that looks like and what the costs are.
Okay. Very good. Thank you. Is there any further questions? If not, all those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those opposed? Thank you. D6 passes, and we'll move into resolutions.
Item E1 is a resolution authorizing the city manager to execute an agreement with De Leon Memorial Incorporated to construct a memorial statue dedicated to Martin De Leon on city property in De Leon Plaza and declaring an effective date.
So moved. We adopt.
Motion. Second. Several motions and seconds. is there any discussion? Thanks, staff. I know y'all put some time in and put together a good agreement. I did review that somewhat, so thank you for that. Okay. All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those opposed? Thank you.
Item E2 is a resolution confirming the appointment of Allison Merrick as assistant city attorney and declaring an effective date.
To adopt.
Second.
We have a motion and a second.
Mayor and Council, yes, I would very much like to introduce Ms. Merrick if she'd like to come forward, as well as Linda Champion, the current assistant city attorney. Mayor and Council, you'll remember that the city charter requires that assistant city attorneys be confirmed by council, and so that's why we have the resolution in front of us tonight. I am very excited to introduce Ms. Merrick to you. She will be coming to us with 8 years of legal experience, both in private practice and in the public sector. And she has a proven interest in city government. She has been serving on the Library Advisory Board, and she currently writes a freelance column on local shopping to help promote local businesses as well. She is very interested in working for the city, and I'm very interested in having her work for the city.
Wonderful. Well, welcome.
Thank you.
It's exciting. Exciting to have you. If you can tolerate a lawyer joke once in a while, we'll all get along just fine.
After 8 years, I'm used to them.
Okay. All right. Council, any comments or discussion?
I just want to thank Linda for her services.
Thank you. This has been a dream job, but it's time for some new blood to get in here and shake things up.
Okay, that's good.
Dream job. Okay. That's wonderful.
Started out a nightmare, but it was
good. Oh, goodness. We won't inquire further about that.
No, I think that needs an explanation. She had just started, and the former city attorney left employment, so, and it was several months before we got another city attorney on board, but Linda did an incredible job in that department, and I can tell you the department heads are going to miss Linda greatly. So, Allison, you've got some big shoes to fill.
I'm fully aware. She can do it.
Very good. I know she can. Excellent. Good. Well, thank you all. All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those opposed? Thank you.
Thank you, Mayor. And I would be remiss if I didn't also say a few words about Linda. I know she doesn't want me to, but I'm going to anyway. Linda is retiring at the end of this year after 7 years of great service to the city. And as Ms. Garrett already mentioned, she came in rocky circumstances and held the rudder firmly in hand, guiding the city through what was a troubled period at the time. She has been that steady hand behind most city contracts over the last 7 years. As you know, any contract or deal with the city that is valued at more than $7,500 gets approved through the legal office, and the vast majority of those have been her hand on the wheel. She's also my trusted advisor. She's perfectly willing to argue with me when she thinks I'm wrong, and I appreciate and respect that in her. I want council members to know how much I have appreciated the work that she has done in serving the citizens of the city.
Excellent.
Thank you, Linda.
Thank you. Okay. You'll let us know when the retirement party is, right, Linda? Okay. You said if we can find you? Okay.
Yes.
All right. Let's moving on. E3.
Item E3 is a resolution authorizing the city manager to execute a professional services agreement with Civil Corps LLC for surveying services for the Red River Reconstruction Project in the amount of $38,000 and declaring an effective date.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? Thank you.
Item E4 is a resolution authorizing the city manager to execute a professional services agreement with Victoria Engineering Incorporated, doing business as Urban Engineering, for engineering services for downtown water and sanitary sewer replacement phase 4 projects 4A, 5A, and 6A in the amount of $316,890 and declaring an effective date.
Move we adopt E4.
Second.
Motion and a second. Any discussion? Okay, Mr. Short, he's still doing a good job for us, Urban Engineering. Okay. I know how valuable that is, and I know how important it is to have a good relationship with that, your engineers, so thank you. Okay, no questions. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, thank you.
Item E5 is a resolution authorizing the city manager to execute a professional services agreement with Urban Surveying Incorporated for surveying services for the Oliver Welder Subdivision Street Reconstruction Project in the amount of $25,000 and declaring an effective date.
Will we adopt E5?
Second.
Motion and second. Is there any discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, same sign. Okay. E6.
E6 is a resolution authorizing the city manager to execute an easement and right-of-way agreement with AEP's Texas Central Company, granting AEP the necessary rights to install electrical service to the Bottom Street Wastewater Lift Station at 1921 Bottom Street, and declaring an effective date.
Second.
Motion, second. Any questions?
Is this overhead or underground? Underground.
Isn't it underground? Yeah, I thought I read it.
Okay.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? Thank you. City manager reports.
Yes, sir. The first one up is Jared, and he's going to stand there and look nice. And because really it's a conversation about the code enforcement. It's more for y'all to tell us what you would like to see changes made to, and you know what, you've had this for a little over a month, so hopefully you've had some chance to look at it.
I have extra copies if somebody didn't.
Well, somebody put a copy out. I'm not sure.
Great.
Miss Scott already Xerox her copy.
Okay. Thank you. So do you want to just, let's go down the list. We can talk about high grass and weeds, and is there any, I think the comment there was to lower the height from 12 inches lower.
In residential areas, inside a neighborhood.
Well,
I assume that's what you would do.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I mean, council, did y'all want to just talk about a specific, or to have Jared, as Ms. Garrett suggested, go down the list? You did this once already.
Yes, we did. We want your input.
Yeah.
And I would prefer we just go down the list.
Okay.
Because that way we can stay on the
yes,
same plane. But
that's fine.
So, and I'm not sure if anybody else has any comments about, you know, what you want to do with the grass.
Okay, so we should comment them at that point. I do not have any, I don't see any changes there.
I think you're going to have a hard time deciding what's the neighborhood and what's not. Where's the neighborhood end and where's the not neighborhood?
And shorter than 12 inches would become problematic. It's probably hard to enforce 12 inches as it is. If you set it to 7 or something, mm-hmm. then you're... Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because I was going to just say, how many complaints have they had for shorter than 12 inches? And based on that, I think you could, if you were going to change anything. But, yeah, I think, you know, you're going to go out there and measure every 5-6 inches, it's going to be ridiculous.
And as a reminder, we're not recommending any changes.
Right.
This was, we were asked to bring back a list of common complaints that we get, and that's exactly what we've created here. So we're happy with the 12 inches.
My concern always has been is that you cannot make people proud of their property, and no amount of code enforcement or code is going to make that happen. We hope we can appeal to people's pride in their property to do a better job of keeping their places looking nice. But code is probably one way to try to encourage them to, but it really doesn't work. If they don't take pride in their property, we can't make them.
Okay. I'm not hearing anything
so
on that one.
Okay. Leave that one alone.
Right-of-way mowing is one that we hear frequently about. You know, as a reminder, a lot of issues that come up is where you have a backyard with a fence that faces a thoroughfare, and that strip of grass that the property owners by code are responsible for mowing behind, you know, to the back of the curb. So some property owners do a good job and some don't. So that's a change. If council wishes for that change to where we start mowing that, we need to bring that back through the budget process because we do not have the resources to take that on at this time.
It's a big one.
See, that's sort of an example of where the 12 inches is a problem, because a lot of those areas, the grass doesn't get 12 inches high, so you don't have the code enforcement aspect of it, but you still have the right-of-way that looks terrible. And I agree with Mr. Halapaska. If you can't take pride in your property, regulation's not necessarily going to do that. But you also don't see the back of your property. Mm-hmm. You know, you drive into your neighborhood and then you go out a different way. You may not ever see that. So that's...
I thought we had asked for an inventory of potential streets or thoroughfares.
You did.
And cost estimates for
We've mowing. Been working on that.
Oh, that's still in development?
Yes.
Oh,
yes, sir.
Okay, good.
But like I just said, that any if there's any change to this, that would have to come through the budget process for 17. So.
And just because we're on this topic again, mm-hmm. and for the public, you know, we were not, right-of-way mowing was not our responsibility to begin with. What was happening was, and I don't want to say this because unfortunately the people that are getting the most angry about this are not going to watch this meeting and not hear my comments, unfortunately, but most of those and a lot of those we were mowing, we were not supposed to be mowing in the first place. And we got it cleaned up, and in terms of, hey, we got accountability for some of these crews and found out they were doing some of this and that's all fixed, and suddenly we stopped mowing it. Well, you know, you tell someone that and they're, y'all always mow it and you're supposed to. Well, we weren't. It was a mistake. And I apologize. And, you know, it is what it is. But I really caution us about this. And I know Ms. Garrett is right about that. It's a big task. And if we ever in the future come to some agreement to take on mowing some right-of-ways, the criteria has to be very objective and blind to who the owner is. You know, you start making exceptions for the elderly or something, it gets very difficult, and we've got this mix match around the city that we'll do this right away, but not this one. So whatever, you know, and I know that's going to come back, and I think it should. There's nothing wrong. I agree with Mr. Alvarez. There's nothing wrong with saying, well, if we can specific right-of-ways identify and apply a number, then it's our decision whether or not we want to spend those resources. I do think over time, citizens are understanding the rules and take 99.9% of everyone mows their right of way because we all have it up to the back of the curb in our front yard. So it's just a few areas that are problematic. So, okay, that's all I want to say.
Overgrown trees and shrubbery.
Okay.
Comments on that?
The overgrown trees.
I do have a question about that. Not so much overgrown trees, but sometimes they overgrow stop signs, speed limit signs, and things of that nature. That then becomes a traffic problem. Do we have something in place to address that?
Yes. We do.
Must be 14 feet high above the roadway.
De Leon Street runs beside my place. There's a bunch of nice trees on it, but they break down in front of the stop signs and everything else. you come right up on one sometimes and you can't. I know they're there because I've been driving out for many years. But
if the shrub or tree is on private property, then they have to trim it up. If it's in the public right of way, we take care of it. But if we see that it's private property and it is causing an impediment on a stop sign or that's a traffic hazard, we will send parks out and they will trim it up immediately. So
if you get within a quarter of a block of it, you can see it, but you couldn't see it from a half a block. Sure. What is the criteria?
Let us take a look at it.
I was going to say, I don't know that I have an exact. It's like, okay, yeah.
So it's on De Leon between Red River or...
Yeah.
Well, we can just look at the entire corridor from Red River to Rio Grande.
I think that was just a general question. What's our rule of thumb? And our rule of thumb
well,
is
others
we're going to look
well.
At it.
I just
yeah.
use
we're
that one because
it.
I
but
see
can,
it daily.
You can go on our online. You can turn in a customer service request at the stop sign at De Leon and Colorado. It was blocked. And a crew will go out and take care of it within a day or two.
But blocked doesn't mean necessarily right up on top of it. If the distance is such that, you know, that's why I asked what is the criteria.
Yeah, he's talking 25 feet back, 50 feet. I don't know that
I
we have
that
a specific
either.
Feet. We're just going to, as we're driving down the road, we're going to look to see if it's.
Okay.
Case yeah. by case.
Yes.
There's so. A lot of, it's all relative. Real quick, the height of trees hanging over the street. I was just talking to Mr. Bocknight. What is the limit? How high?
It's 8 foot over a sidewalk, 14 foot over
14.
The street.
Okay.
The pavement.
Yeah, that came up in conversation the other day. I was thinking it was like 20 feet, but.
No.
Okay. Very good. Parking in residential areas?
I don't know. I'd like to see something, but it really opens up a big slippery slope. But I've had a number of people comment about people that their whole front yard is covered with vehicles. And you know, as I think about it, I think in a progression, everybody goes through a stage where their teenage kids have extra vehicles and they have a lot of vehicles around. But, you know, when it becomes something that's a 5 years running, it starts to look like, well, maybe that wasn't just that situation. I know people have lots of kids, but and that's not necessarily the point, but it's just... when you get a house that's got a lot of vehicles in the front yard and all the houses on up and down the street aren't the same. And I know the mayor has said that too, that everybody deserves to live next to, you know, a nice looking house.
Did I say that?
Well, I was told that you said that.
Yeah, I understand. I understand. Mr. Halpaska?
I believe there's somewhat of a cause and effect on some of these ideas. And that is when we review subdivision ordinances allow for narrow streets, that's fine when it's a young family and two cars. Mm-hmm. And when you get to be teenagers, there's a bunch of them and they got to park somewhere and the streets are too narrow. Which came first, the chicken or the egg? Did we cause the problem by allowing narrow subdivision streets in the first place?
Well,
it's just a matter of time before it's going to occur.
What's the off-street parking requirements?
New houses are required to have two paved off-street parking spaces, just two.
Driveway, yeah.
But you have, you know, this, the parking in the residential, in front of a front yard of a residential is a little more complicated. You have streets like Sam Houston, Crestwood, Red River, where you have residential houses that front on that street. When they were built, that was just a residential street like every other street in their neighborhood, and we went in and turned it into a four-lane roadway and prohibited parking on it, so... But if they lived a block back on Colorado, they'd be allowed to park on the street. So it's a little, it's complicated. But we do get complaints all the time from, I don't know, pick your neighborhood, Fleetwood or something, and there's one house that has three teenagers or something, and they park all in the yard, and it drives the neighbor crazy.
Then there's also the issue, I mean, vehicles is one thing, boats, trailers, RVs.
Get that a lot. Complaints about a flatbed or a boat being parked in the front yard. It's not a code violation. Nothing I can do about it.
Deer stands.
Anything you can think of.
Oh, yeah.
They complain about
machines.
It. I think I don't. I would just to add to the discussion. Obviously, additional cars from teenage drivers, but there's also a lot of multiple families living in single family homes. I can, you can go. There's a lot of that going on, and there's six cars. And you think, how many people live there? I know of a dozen people in two-bedroom homes. And if it's an economic situation, I don't know. But that causes a lot of issues. So,
I think a lot of the complaints when people speak up is not so much that there are a lot of cars in that area. It's there's a car. Oh, it's still there. Hey, it was there 2 days ago. It's still there. So it's, you know, I think that's the kind of thing that people are more concerned about. But it's, again, it's their front yards.
I thought we had something in there about it being operable.
Explain the enforcement component, because an abandoned or one that doesn't have a registration sticker and certain other elements after a short period is required to be...
To be considered a junk vehicle under the Texas Transportation Code, it has to be inoperable and have expired registration or inspection sticker. Of course, now that's one sticker now, but it has to have both of those.
Is that
elements.
What you're referring to, Ms. Klein?
Well, partially.
We've gotten complaints with cars that are perfectly operable.
Yeah,
they literally
right.
are parking in the front yard in a neighborhood, and the residents next door don't park in their on the front grass and upset about it.
But they can be covered too, right? If it's there's something covering the visual from the street.
Or you can put it in your backyard and out of view.
And then sometimes they are parked and cross over the sidewalk. You know, they're in mm-hmm. the driveway.
Which you're not supposed to.
There are so many of them that you can't walk down the sidewalk. And it's a...
In some of our older neighborhoods, Cimarron's a good example of that, where... The building setback line was different than it is today. You could put your garage 15 foot from the property line, and so therefore, everybody loves their trucks, and so your truck sticks out and blocks the sidewalk. Today we require a 20 foot setback for a garage, and so that helps alleviate that a little bit more. But Cimarron's a good example of a neighborhood where that setback was smaller, and so those corner lot homes, a lot of them have. Side-loaded garages and vehicles sticking in the sidewalk, no matter what size the car is.
It's a tricky problem. You know, I, of anything on this list, considering changing might be this, but probably not. This is just me speaking. I would prefer a community standard, a neighborhood standard of expectations evolve out there, and I think it does. I've had in my 7 or 8 years, however long I've been part of the city government, in the Northcrest area, watch some situations arise where you have some very nice homes and someone moves in and three flatbed trailers, deer stand, and, you know, somebody knowing what I'm talking about probably was aware of the house. It rectified itself. The people didn't stay, but during that year or two, it was very frustrating to a few of the neighbors because they sure let me know about it. But, you know, those property rights in Texas, and we hold them very sacred, and it's frustrating. But again, a community standard, a set of expectations where a neighbor could say, you know, you really shouldn't do that, or someone who would be so concerned about their neighbors that they wouldn't do it. Y'all understand mm-hmm. what I'm saying. I would hope that we can stick with that without adding more regulations. I don't know. Just my thoughts.
And then the next statement down there about RVs, boats, flatbed yeah. trailers, you cannot store that vehicle on the street longer than 24 hours. So that's a police enforcement issue, and if you will call, the police department will look at that. So,
but that's why they end up in the front yard.
Probably.
Exactly.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Commercial dumpsters? Thoughts?
I'm not sure what to say about this one, Jared. I don't, you know, that there has to be a screening fence right now between the residential home and the commercial. So,
but you know, as we've seen some of the newer apartment complexes, you know, build up in areas that have been vacant for years, they put the dumpsters at the back of the property, and guess what's on the other side of that back fence? But you know, other single family houses, and so we've had some complaints about. Why did we let the dumpster go there?
When did that go into effect? So,
which
the
screening?
Screening, yes.
I think they came out of the first comprehensive plan, probably 2002, maybe.
So
2003.
So, businesses, things that predate that.
Things that predate that, the dumpster's out there. There's no screening required.
What about hours of dumping?
Did we regulate that with our contract?
Pick
we
might. Pickup is picking loud. Up. Boom. Yeah.
The pickup, you know, occurs at 5 in the morning?
4 o'clock. We allow them to start at 4 a.m. for commercial. And that's mainly so they can get down to Vero, Laurent, Main Street. We've got rest homes, different places that they've got to back out onto Navarro, back out onto Main Street. So it's a safety concern. It's been like that since I've been in this business since 89. We don't get very few, maybe once a year I'll get a complaint about somebody hearing a dumpster being dumped in the morning, but they stick mostly to Navarro, some places downtown, but it's mostly the business sections. The rest of the town they do after 8 o'clock, after their first load.
Most of the time our windows are closed. It's too hot, so I know exactly what you're talking about. So, deed restrictions, any... Okay.
Okay.
Building, well, you know, I was just, my thought, some of these other issues we've talked about are often addressed by deed restrictions, which
sure,
are good, too.
Sure.
So,
mm-hmm.
Building aesthetics.
I've been approached about that a number of times, and the answer seems to lie somewhere in the deed restrictions are so varied from one neighborhood to the next. It'd be a train wreck and a nightmare just trying to keep up with all the various deed restrictions. I don't know how we could,
yeah,
if we choose to.
Yeah. I'm not about to tell anybody what color to paint their house or what kind of roof to put on it. I don't know about you guys. I suspect y'all feel the same. So, rental registration. What is... Oh, okay. Isn't there considerable state law covering this kind of thing already? No inspections, but...
There's no required state inspection, mm-hmm, to rent out an apartment.
What I meant was there is a lot of laws covering, you know, they have to have window screens and stuff, right?
Those are part of our minimum housing codes.
Okay. Okay.
We do not
inspect
the unit unless we've gotten a complaint about a substandard structure issue. But there's not some sort of...
And this just comes up when a resident in an apartment rental unit or apartment complex is not happy with the upkeep and that they're not satisfied with their landlord, and they call us asking us for what can you do. Well, there's not anything we can do unless it's substandard. So
it's not surprising.
This could take care of itself with the large amount of apartments that have come online in the last year. The economic forces would take care of some of this. If your landlord won't keep your property up, perhaps they'd have a better chance.
Well, I think, too, it's affordability issue, yeah, for those that probably fall in the affordable area, you know.
If we had something like this, would we pick up a violation or pick up a building falling into disrepair sooner? And would we be able to do anything about it? I guess it's the second part of that. Obviously, we can address it when it mm-hmm, is a dangerous situation. But if we inspected it and saw that it was heading that way but not there yet, would this solve anything?
Sure, it would. It would let us begin to address a lot of the substandard, dilapidated, slumlord, to use that term, kind of properties. This is a staffing issue for us, though. So this, if we went down this path, this is a staffing issue for us. I do not have the staff to do some sort of annual inspection on units. But it would mean if we implemented as some of the other cities have done, they'd have to have an annual inspection or biannual inspection. If the unit doesn't pass inspection, it cannot be occupied. So there's the carrot and the stick of that.
Do we have authority to conduct inspections now without having this type of thing?
Health and safety, yeah, fall under health and safety.
Right. If we have reason to know that it exists.
There's some powers that the building official has, and I guess and or the fire marshal, but.
Yep. Without requiring it to be an annual thing, we still would be able to if we had reason.
Reasonable cause or probable cause to do it.
I guess it would just trigger a fine as opposed to you can't occupy this until you pass. That's the difference there, right?
Right.
So we would just be fining, okay.
It could essentially, if the building is such a degree of some substandard, it could be referred to the Building Standards Commission for action at that point.
Julie. So we often get stuck in the middle whenever you have an unhappy tenant, water heater, things like that. And oftentimes, they call us and we go out there and we do have tools to remedy the situation, but then they get scared. They don't want to get evicted. They can't find other affordable housing. And so then they stop cooperating. And a rental registration program, while we don't have the staff, one benefit would be that we don't get these units occupied. We don't get put in the middle. And this happens on a very regular basis. It's not just a couple times a year. This is a type of call that we see regularly. And we also get the calls for the most egregious type of issues. This would head off some of the smaller maintenance type things as well. But there is a huge staffing implication, and we don't have that at the moment.
Thank you. Okay. Well, I'm going to move on. There's on the back page, tents.
I think we've talked about tents enough.
Yeah. I don't think there's any desire to change anything regarding that. Outdoor storage of display merchandise for sale. I remember a lot of discussion in the master plan about this many years ago, I think. Thoughts? Anybody? Concerns?
I think you can legislate taste.
You can't legislate taste is what Mr. Balknight said. Okay. I tend to agree with you, sir. Well, I would suggest if anyone has individual issues with this to visit with city manager,
sure.
Perhaps going
thank
forward.
You.
Thank you for
thank
you for the review.
Don't go too far.
I might ask one thing.
Yes, sir.
When it comes to code, are we looking at getting rid of antiquated code that's no longer applicable, and any other potential code that just doesn't make sense anymore, just to streamline our code?
Yes, sir. We're in the process right now reviewing all of our codes from the beginning to the end. It will be a lengthy process, though.
It'll be a few years out.
Well, I hope not that long, so I would like to start bringing code revisions back to y'all later in 16, after we've had a chance to go through all the chapters. And one of our projects is when we have a small revision in a code, we need to look at the whole code and not just one section of the code, of that chapter or that section, and make sure it's flowing together. So, but no, sir, we're working on that.
Good, thank you.
Is this still illegal to ride your horse on the sidewalk?
I believe that's state law. I don't think there's anything in our local ordinances about that. I don't remember.
That
I thought it was still in the code.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Thank you. Well, annexation.
Yeah. Moving on to another fun topic.
Let me tee Jared up here in a sense. We've had some involuntary annexations requests. Over a year ago, we brought forth some annexations. They failed. But with the voluntary annexations coming back, we think we need to relook at some of those properties that we would recommend we do annexations on. So, I asked Jarrett tonight to talk about those properties we would bring forth and start the process at the next meeting, after we get input from you guys. So, Jarrett, go ahead. Sorry.
Sure. As Ms. Garrett said, we went back and looked at a couple of areas. Basically, the proposal or the what's in front of you would really affect just three property owners, the developer of Lake Forest, and there's a little bit of Ball Airport right-of-way that the city owns there as annexation area one. And then also looking over at Ball Airport Road for the Tuscany subdivision area two, there are two property owners there. The developer of Tuscany subdivision and the Schmitz that own the property just right across from the new fire station number six. So it's a relatively small number of affected property owners, but these are the two areas where we're seeing repetitive voluntary annexations for small little tracts of land. I think we just finished one that was 9.5 feet wide by 800 feet deep or something. So each one of those take quite a bit of staff time, 3 council meetings to get through all of that, and staff would suggest that we consider taking care of these two areas and just bringing in the remainder of those undeveloped phases of those subdivisions and eliminating the need for that repetitive work happening.
And these are willing property owners.
I didn't say that.
Okay.
Well, I mean, I think they've been doing voluntary. Their property's been platted, Jared?
As each time they submit a final plat, they're required to do voluntary annexation.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why we've been doing little pieces at a time. There's a lot of paperwork, a lot of rigmarole that we go through with each one of those. I think we did 3 or 4 Lake Forest voluntary annexations and little 2 to 3 acre tracts last year, and a little bit bigger on the Tuscany side.
Well, the revenue impact is fairly small to the property owners.
Right, it's the undeveloped land, raw land, and so it doesn't have much of a financial impact on those property owners.
The amount of work your department's having to do to nibble at these properties and go through this entire process with us is far exceeds the value of that little bit of revenue. So it makes a lot of sense from that standpoint.
I felt like we needed to bring it back for consideration, but we wanted to do the report first. So go ahead, Jared.
If you're okay with moving forward, what would happen is we would notify the property owners, come back to you. We'd notify the property owners in January, come back to you with a resolution directing staff to prepare a service plan. You'd have 2 public hearings at your meetings in February and the actual annexation ordinance at the 2 meetings in March. So it'll take 90 days at least to get through all of that process. But
did we specifically skip Ball Airport itself? Because it's done in small chunks like that as well, is it not?
Talking about Steve Klein's subdivision. Yes. When you say Ball Airport, are you talking about Steve Klein's subdivision?
All of Steve
it's
Klein's
already
in
the city limits.
I'm sorry?
It's already annexed into the city limits.
Okay.
Steve is. Yes.
I thought we were doing small chunks on it as well.
No.
No, sir.
It's all in, all the way back there to Bianchi Road.
Mm-hmm.
Correct. Thank you.
Okay. Okay. So we will bring back, we'll start that process in January then.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you, Jared.
Thank you.
So the next manager report is Donald Reese is going to do a UBO software update to show what the public portal works on this new software, how citizens can go in and look at their accounts.
Bear with me. We'll get this set back up. Just take a second here.
So we just have one screen working tonight.
Okay. Good evening, Mayor, members of council. The goal tonight is to give y'all a brief tour of the new customer service portal that we have recently implemented while we were implementing our new utility billing software. I call it a customer service portal because it's not just a payment portal like we've had in the past. There's quite a few other things that you can do with it. And as we go through this, if you have any questions, just feel free to ask me. As you can see, we're at our City of Victoria homepage. Click on our utility bill pay link up here, and you're taken to the screen that's actually Invoice Cloud. It takes you to the Invoice Cloud website, which is our third-party payment provider who processes all of our payments. And on the left-hand side here, you can read some of the, basic items that they have. Pay and view your bill. They talk about our $3 convenience fee. They talk about how safe and secure it is. Show you that we have an eco-friendly option, paperless option. And then at the bottom, they give you some a phone number and then some email addresses in case you have any questions or any service requests. You can click on those links, and it'll open up your email, and you can send an email to one of our supervisors or managers. We have two ways that you can, I say two ways, there are several payment methods, but there's two ways that you can actually make a payment. And I'll go through the first one is what we call a one-time payment. It's down here on the bottom. Click on that link. And what you do here is basically you're just trying to make a single payment. You don't want to do anything else. That's all it is. So go in here and enter an account number. I'm going to enter my account number if I can. And then see if I got this right. And what you're going to see is some of my history. As you're going to notice, I don't have a balance due right now. I'm on auto draft. So
that's a good thing.
Yeah, good thing. So unfortunately, we're not going to be able to go in and look at how we actually make a payment, which is actually kind of a good thing, because when you get into the payment screen, there's a little bit of additional personal information that comes up on your screen. So I wouldn't feel comfortable showing that here at this meeting. But if y'all want to see that later on, I'll be happy to show you that kind of off to the side. But what you would do is basically click on the bill that you'd like to pay, add it to your shopping cart. And when you go into the actual payment screen, it'll give you an option of would you like to pay this using a credit card, or would you like to use an e-check? And an e-check is basically just a digital check. So it's another payment tool that we haven't had in the past. And if you set up your e-checks, there is no charge for that, no $3 fee for that one. So we can go down here, and if you wanted to view the bill, you can view this bill. I'm sorry it's cutting it off a little bit here, it appears to, but as you go down, you'll see that it shows you your previous balance, previous payment. And this is basically just a view of your bill, and shows you all of your individual charges: water, sewer, garbage, bulk, brushy, recycle, yard waste, HHW, and then the tax associated with those garbage. And then you also see a graphical representation of your usage over the past time. And I know it's kind of hard to see down here, but it actually says May through September.
Tom.
Yes, ma'am.
I just wanted to point out that if you have more than one trash can, it shows each card individually. So therefore, y'all have a line item that says other charges or other services.
Yes, ma'am. There is
that
other.
You know, it rolls everything else into there, and that's where I was having my questions on my bill until somebody went in and pointed that out. That because there's no room left,
right?
Y'all just wrap. You know, I think it was like the yard waste and the hazard waste was all wrapped into one, and we couldn't figure out where the bill was coming from.
Okay.
So
okay.
Just FYI for other people that see other services, it's because it's wrapping it right there into that one line item.
That's a good. I'm glad you brought that to my attention. What I'll try to do is see if there's a way we can maybe make some more room on this bill. This isn't what's actually mailed out. So we have a little bit of room on this that we can play with, and maybe I can get a little bit more room in there.
Yeah, because the one that I get mailed out does have it wrapped into one. Okay.
Okay. Okay. So now, as I said, this is basically just your tool to just come in and make a payment and view your bill. That's all this one is for. If we go back, There we go. Okay, I guess I'm going to have to go and start it over. I'm sorry. So if we go back, we have a section up here at the top where you can register. And what I mean by register is you put in some additional information, email address, and you sign up to get these additional services. And I'm sorry, I forgot to mention, I set a piece of paper in front of each of y'all that kind of shows these features, and I should have mentioned this when I started. I apologize. And these additional features that you can see on this section include you have the ability to schedule payments at future dates. You can sign up for email reminders, and those reminders include a bill notice, a late notice, disconnect notice, a scheduled payment reminder. So if I've scheduled a payment for, 2 days from now, and I get that email that says, hey, you've got a scheduled payment coming on Thursday, I can click and say, oh, I need to either transfer some money into that account, or I don't have money, I need to cancel that you know, that scheduled payment and do it at some other time. So that's a handy feature. And then you can also get emails about rejected payments. If you had an e-check that was sent back insufficient, or if you had a declined credit card, it would email and let you know so that you don't go into a delinquent status. So I've already registered, and what I'll do here is plug in my email address. Sorry, I'm not used to using this laptop, so. And my password. And then they make you type this thing in so you're not some computer. And sometimes I have a hard time reading if that's an E or an F or what that is.
This was two Fs.
Yeah, apparently I was wrong. I guessed wrong. I must be a computer. A-V. Yeah, I'm a bot. A-V-A 5-Q. Does that look right?
Yep.
Yes, sir.
All right, let's try it again. It's thinking. Okay, so one item that I forgot to mention that's brand new, and this is what this tutorial is, this YouTube tutorial down here is it's a brand new feature where, say, a landlord has a bunch of rental properties, and he or she has their name on all the utility accounts. They can set up all those accounts onto one login and make one payment whenever they want and not have to go in and log in multiple times to make those payments, just a one-time deal. It saves quite a bit of time. We've had some customers say they really enjoy that feature. Okay, so here we are in the registered. Here's some additional items that I can do. Of course, I can view or pay my open invoices. Unfortunately, I don't have any open invoices, so if I do a search for those, it's not going to pull anything up. But I can look at my payment history, and we'll set that date range back to, I guess May 1st would be okay. And you can see, here's my payment history back from August till now. And again, you can go in here and look at if you would like to get a PDF version of your bill, you can do that. Some people want to keep a hard copy, or some people want to put it into a file. Open that, and it just shows you the PDF, and it shows you the same data that you saw a while ago. Or you can just choose to look at it like what we did a while ago. And that's just a view of your bill. Shows the same thing that we saw a while ago. The other thing that you can do is, if you have a lot of these accounts, or if you have several charges over the next couple of years and you want to see this in an easy fashion, you can put this in a Excel spreadsheet form. Brings all that up. That could be handy to someone that has multiple accounts or has a long history. All right, so here we go to view your paid or closed invoices. And what you can do is you can search your invoice history here by entering different dates, different dollar amounts. If you have a certain invoice that you know was $85 and you have a long list and you don't want to have to search through all these, you can enter that in here and it'll pull it up for you pretty fast. That way you don't have to scroll through everything. Again, you can download, you can view this payment option. I don't have any payments as of today on these. I mean, my balances are all past. My balances are all paid. The adjustments will show you any adjustments you've made to it. Of course, in this one, it was my payment. But if there's any adjustments like to your bill that you had, a non-payment fee added after that bill, well, that'll show up there. Or if for some reason there was a credit to your account, that'll show up on there. Just whatever, any miscellaneous non-bill charge will show up under adjustments. And then you can also see any scheduled payments, and I don't have any scheduled payments at this time. Again.
Donald, can you view water activity with your, not payment activity, usage. But usage activity?
The usage activity at this time, the only way you can view it is to look at your latest bill, and you'll see that. Okay. You'll see that usage chart.
So the portal for the public is mainly dealing with their payments?
It's mainly dealing with the payments and then setting up various methods of how to pay and then looking at your usage history by looking at your bill.
Okay.
That would be handy to have.
Yeah. Well, I think it's an option that we could add maybe later.
I can look into that. That's not a problem. I can definitely contact them and look into it. So here's where you can kind of set up under my profile is where you set up your payment methods. This is where you're going to add a new bank account. And you'll tie that bank account to your e-check or to your auto draft. And then you can also add a credit card. And once you've added your bank account or added your credit card, you can go back under here and you can go to auto pay. And at that time, you can set up your scheduled payments through auto pay. I don't have that set up because I've had the auto draft ever since it was ACH, so I've kind of, when I converted over, my account converted over, it's got the old auto draft instead of the new e-check. So switching, coming down to paperless options. You can see I've signed up for the paperless options. When you sign up for the paperless options, that you can get the emails. You'll automatically get all the emails. So you'll get the ones that we talked about, but you still can get those emails and not go paperless if that's what you choose. Some people just like to have that hard copy bill in their hand every month. I've gotten to where I don't need it. It's fine. I'll get an email with it. And then you can, if somebody has multiple accounts, they can manage their accounts here, you know, keep their email addresses current. And the last thing we have here is on the support side, your customer support gives you a link to our billing supervisor. And any questions that you have or service that you need, you can click on this link and send an email. And I'll be happy to answer any questions that you might have.
Pretty cool.
Mr. Faulkner, is that what you were looking for? Or?
Yeah, I thought we were going to get the...
Usage did, yeah.
So I can. Yeah, you can get your past history. Make sure
payment
that
history.
I'm sorry, payment history.
No, you can get your
consumption.
The little graph that's on the PDF.
You can get the graph on your last bill, but there's not a separate section.
I can't look over the past year.
Well, it would just be your past year. Once we've had this. Okay, let me go back to one. That shows. Now keep in mind, we've only had this system it's been up and running about 4 months, so you're only going to have 4 months of it.
So in April of 2016, when I have a bill, that will give me 9 months of my history?
Basically 9 months when you look at the chart on your bill. But
okay.
I mean, if y'all are interested in having something on the website, I can definitely look into that. That's separate from having to pull up a bill. I'll be happy to talk to him about
if
that.
If I wanted to actually see my real-time usage, let's say I got a large bill, wondered what went wrong, and I went down, can they draw that up for me and show the hours of the day?
That's a separate system. That's through our AMR system. And if you call us and ask for that, we can pull that chart up, and we can do it for the month, the day. We can even drill down to the hour for that. That's been a very handy tool. We've used that quite a bit.
Well, an acquaintance of mine had a commercial rental property, and he was paying the water bill, and every so often the water bill would go out of sight. Found out a guy had come over there at 9 or 10 o'clock at night and fill up his 500-gallon water tank with a garden hose.
Oh.
That's how they were able to catch him.
I would love to see that level, that granular level of usage available to us without having to call you. Okay. It's probably just money. It's probably another module, but... I would love to see that. I want to see if there's any water going through my house at 2 in the morning to see if I have a leak.
Okay.
Be great.
I can look to see what I need to do to have that, to see that, make that happen.
Depends on how much it costs, you know.
Yep. So. There is a customer portal with our Census FlexNet system, but when it first came out, it was brand new. They were having a lot of glitches with it, and it was pretty expensive. But I'll be happy to call those people, and we've got a good relationship with them, and see what's the deal with it now.
Okay. Thank you.
No problem.
Thank you. So the last item tonight is Lynn's going to hand out some putty for y'all to play with. You all have been made aware of the problems that we're having in the streets in Woodway, and we did the seal coat and how it's continued to have failures. And so Lynn went back and did soil samples throughout the neighborhood. So he's going to talk to you tonight about what the findings were, but what he is handing out is what the base on that road is like. Yes. And it should not, you should not be able to take base of a road and play with it like it's pliable.
Correct.
So, anyway, and the engineers in the back are laughing at me, so I'm sure.
Yes, that's correct. If y'all will remember, in FY 2014, we applied a hot mix level up and a double seal coat to the streets in the Woodway subdivision in an effort to save those streets from complete failure. They had not been previously sealed since the early 1990s. In early 2015, after we had completed that work, of course, the city received 40-plus inches of rainfall that saturated the base under that new seal coat. And shortly thereafter, we began seeing failures in the streets, especially on Woodridge Drive. Those failures have continued to appear throughout the neighborhood, especially during and following rainfall events. Now, the street department has gone out and dug out and repaired some of those failures, but extensive repairs need to be made in that subdivision, much more than we will be able to address just using our street department. While digging those repairs up, we noticed, of course, that both the base and the subgrate were just very wet, saturated throughout. Our engineering department has gone out with the assistance of Civil Corps, dug up some samples of that base, found it to be polluted with clay and silt from the subgrade, and those are some of the samples that you have before you now. We went and dug those up this afternoon, and that's still how wet the subgrade, and that's base, of course. So once we saw that, we realized we needed to get some expert advice. So we hired a soils engineer out of Houston called Terracon to come in and take core samples throughout the subdivision. They took 30 cores at locations that we chose, not in failures, but in areas that weren't showing failure at the time. We knew pretty much what the failures were doing. We wanted to see in these other locations what the base looked like, what the subgrade looked like. Our hope was that we could narrow where these failures were and predict where the failures were going to occur and hopefully eliminate some areas that we wouldn't necessarily rebuild. Some of their findings, we recently got Terracon's report, and so that's why we're before you tonight to talk about what their findings were and their recommendations. The number of findings. One is that the base and subgrade were extremely wet, which you can see. The moisture content in those cores ranged between 10 and 44% moisture. Normally, we would expect to see 5 to 8% moisture in the base. Base thickness is another finding. You know, typically, we would, installing streets under today's street standards, you would see 9.5 inches of base uniformly throughout the subdivision. What they found here was a base thicknesses that ranged between 5 and 11 inches depending on where you cored. Also, the aggregate in that base is very small. It's not crushed. It's still round aggregate, but it's very small. Lots of fines. not much rock. And then the final finding was the subgrade had a very high plasticity index. That's why when you grab those Ziploc bags, you can squeeze that, and it's like Play-Doh. It's very elastic, very plastic. The PI range out there was 7 to 40. And typically, we would hope to see less than a 12 throughout the subdivision. What's there is a very weak, non-supportive clay material. And we found it throughout the neighborhood. We were unable to isolate any small or large, any areas, period, that didn't need some work. So TerraCon made two recommendations. The first was, they said you could reclaim and overlay those streets out there, which means basically mixing the asphalt and base up, stabilizing it, and setting it back in. But they recommended, in order to get a substantial enough foundation for the traffic, especially the garbage truck traffic, they would recommend 10 inches of a lime ash stabilized base with a 2-inch hot mix overlay on top of it. We estimate that cost to be $2.2 million, which is good. It's better than the second option I'm going to talk to you about. However, from a constructability standpoint, that is not a valid option, in our opinion. It's not practical because there's not 10 inches of base there now. There's between 5 and 11, depending on where you are. So you can't just mix that up. You'd have to bring in additional base to get to that 10 inches. Well, there's not room to put 10 inches without that getting way up into the gutter and above the curb in some locations. So now what you'd be talking about doing would be digging up that base, stockpiling it, if there were a place to stockpile it, which there's not, but if there were a place you could stockpile it, then you would have to dig up the subgrade to a depth to where you could put 10 inches of base where it would accommodate it. You put the old base back, you bring in new base to make it 10 inches, then treat it, mix it, set it in. And then they say there could still be soft spots, and so what they recommend is proof rolling it, and then when you find weak spots, dig that base up and haul it off and bring in new base. It's just not a practical solution. The other option, of course, they say is complete rebuild using a lime stabilized subgrade, a geogrid, 8 inches of limestone, double seal coat, and an inch and a half of hot mix. We estimate that to be $3.67 million worth of work. That is our recommendation also for fixing those roadways out there. Of course, we don't have funding for that in our current CIP. So our plan would be then when we come back this spring and bring before you recommendations for CIP, we would try to integrate this repair in that CIP. By then we will have a good recommendation for you, a plan of how to fund that. During the interim, we will continue monitoring the roadway conditions out there. We'll send the street department out when needed to dig up and make some point repairs to keep it drivable. And then, of course, going forward, what we will do to try to prevent this, you know, prevent seal coating streets where, of course, we couldn't have predicted that we were going to get this 40 inches of rain, but we will start taking base samples prior to recommending streets for seal coat. We've done that on Meadow Creek. We're fixing to start Meadow Creek. We went out taking base samples. The base there is good and solid and is, I think, good candidates for the process that we're fixing to move forward with, and we'll just integrate that into our plan. But that's what we have to deal with, that base has become so saturated, the subgrade saturated, and that subgrade is pumped up into the base and basically polluted it. And I forgot to give you this sample. This is what we would expect. If you have questions, I'll try to address them.
So you're saying
put into the proper standards at that time?
We had that conversation internally, and there's no way for us to know.
Yeah.
And, you know, and that's a good reminder, you know, the developers build the street to the street standards at the time. And we suspect a lot of the streets were built back in the 70s. So we have no way, current staff has no way of knowing whether it was built to standards or not. But we know those standards aren't as good as they should have been back then, but it's Absolutely. What we had. Yep. So we've improved those standards through the years, and recently, I guess last year, improved them again. So going forward, but we do, Lynn mentioned it, and going forward, we'll do soil samples before we do the seal coats, and, you know, we caught it before we got into Meadow Creek. So, you know, wish we'd had the hindsight, but we didn't. So, and again, we were trying to do a maintenance on that road to hold it together for another 7 years to get it to a rebuilt state. So we'll just have to try to rebuild it a little bit sooner.
Mr. Alvarez had a comment.
No, it was along those lines, but you think the rain kind of sped the process along?
Absolutely, I do. Yes, sir, Councilman.
Concerned about the homes out there and how stabilized their foundations are.
They're all cracked. If you know everybody's foundation's cracked, y'all would probably agree, some of you. Anyway, it doesn't mean that there's anything wrong, but I think Mr. Bocknight, he's in the business, would agree. They all, in Victoria, they all crack.
What's your black gumbo and cornfields?
I am understanding that the streets are failing, but, I mean, we had 40 inches of rain all over town, so why is this stuff so wet?
I believe it's a combination of the subgrade that was underneath the basis there was very high PI clay and silt, not very good soil conditions for
like it didn't drain or
wasn't prepared.
Okay.
Yeah, and then you've got a base on top of it that had small round aggregate that did not block together and make a seal. You have thickness is not it's not uniform throughout it, and then you got all that rain that went in underneath the curbs, wicked into that base and subgrade. It had a new seal above it, so it was sealed on top, and then it started pumping as equipment moved on it, and silt and mud has come up into the base. And
the reason we added GeoGrid to the specs was to keep the subsoil from mixing with your base. If your base goes away, you got nothing. It's just on whatever mud there is there or whatever. And that is why it just delays the mixing over time as it expands and contracts and dry and wet. It will have a tendency to mix with the subsoil. The GeoGrid just delays that and extends the life of it in an economic way that keeps that from happening as quickly.
So these were built in the 70s, late 70s, and I don't know if we had a street standard, but it was, you know, obviously I...
Paper mache.
Yeah, I was under the impression the early 90s we got a pretty serious standard in place. I want to say 92. I don't know why I think that. Somewhere right 92, 94 was the first serious standard. And then, you know, was anyone inspecting back in the 70s? Did the city? I don't know.
And we didn't spend time doing research because it really doesn't matter.
Right, right.
It's so, a long, you know, time anyway.
It is.
And, you know, I would say that I'll bet in this room the person that feels the worst about the situation is at the podium right now, because I know he cares, and this is very frustrating for him and all of us. You go in with a set of assumptions, and those assumptions have been safe in other neighborhoods, right? I mean, we've never had to do core samples in some neighborhoods, and so the confluence of rain, particular the timing of the age of the road, the particular subgrade, perhaps we could criticize in hindsight the person who built the roads. I don't know if that's fair, whatever, it doesn't matter. We wouldn't do anything different. If you could go back in time a year from now, you would still recommend the same course of action. So unfortunately, it didn't work out. You know, I know we all want to do it right, and that's what you're going to do. You know, just 100 yards away, B.J. Davis's newest roads are built to the current standard. I would suspect the soil conditions there are not much different. They're along that creek, you know, between the highway and the creek. And we'll see. I'm sure those roads are a whole other story. And they were all built in the last few years.
Well, Mr. Your point of we have to deal with what we find is what happened on Laurent. We were finding gas lines that weren't even standard for the 50s. They were near the surface, and they weren't supposed to even be there. It doesn't matter if it's true or not. We still have to deal with it.
Yeah.
And no action, just a report, and we'll you'll see it again in the CPI when we bring that back in the spring. So, but at least when you get questions from the neighbors that went, the residents of Woodway, you'll at least have an be able to answer
their questions.
Thank
you for taking all the time to look into that in such good detail. That's be helpful to me.
Thank you. Thank you, Lynn.
That concludes your report.
It does.
And that concludes our agenda. So thank you, Council. We're adjourned.